Welcome back, Daily Caller. I am senior White House correspondent Christian Daytok. Today, I'm sitting down with Robert Petillo, a civil rights activist, criminal defense attorney, and radio host from Atlanta, Georgia. We're talking about all things George Floyd today. Robert, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me on.
And to all of our viewers out there, I want to remind you to hit subscribe and click the bell so that you get notified every time one of these interviews goes live. Robert, let's take a step back to Monday, because President Trump gave what some viewed as a particularly charged speech to the response to the demonstrations that took place across the nation over the weekend. He vowed to restore law and order. He urged the governors to deploy the National Guard and said if that they didn't do that, he would send in the military. What was your initial reaction to the president's speech?
Well, my immediate reaction is that is a law and order is a term of art in American politics. Mm-hmm. If you go back to the 1968 election, that is a term that Nixon used, that Strom Thurmond used, that George Wallace used, that Lee Atwater used, with regards to riots after the assassination of Dr. King and riots regarding the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. So when you say law and order in American politics, you are particularly bringing up or referencing the police crackdowns in the late 60s when you're talking about things like Kent State, where you're talking about the efforts of groups such as the Citizens Council to quell the civil rights movement. So I don't think that was done accidentally. It was very intentionally used. You can actually look up President Nixon ads from the 1968 election where they say almost the exact same thing and have the exact same imagery that President Trump was using, and then to follow it up with the clearing of the crowd in Lafayette Park. And then his triumphant march across the street to the church. It was very troubling imagery because it definitely brought back ideas of the 1960s and this idea of beating back hippies and beatniks and restoring law and order to the American population. So I think at a time when the nation really needs healing, where military and violence is the last thing we should be talking about, we should be discussing how do we bridge the gaps between us socioeconomically, racially, politically. I don't think a militaristic speech about dominating the opposition and bringing back law and order, I don't think that has worked in the last several days to really heal what we're trying to do in this country.
Yeah, it was an interesting moment in time because it seemed to be we were at a breaking point here in the district. Things were getting increasingly violent. That being said, Monday night, Tuesday night, after that slight incident in Lafayette Square that you just mentioned, the protests have been almost 100% peaceful. And on Tuesday night, we even saw the largest gathering of folks that have come out yet. So whether that's because of the president's words or because of the protesters taking it upon themselves to demonstrate in a peaceful manner, it looks like we're back on the right track here. That being said, this is only one part of the problem. The other half of the answer comes from what the government can do, both the federal government and local governments. What do you think President Trump should do in order to heal some of this hurt and actually put through meaningful reforms that make sure that this type of police injustice doesn't happen in the future?
Well, I think that's the point, the meaningful reforms. If you look at what the laws are today regarding police brutality and what the laws were when the LA riots happened after Rodney King was beat in the early 1990s, the laws are exactly the same. People, if you think about the last 10 years of American politics, after Trayvon, people marched with sweet tea, hoodies, and iced tea to address the killings of unarmed black men. When you look at Eric Garner, people put on T-shirts that said, "I can't breathe," to protest the police killing of unarmed black men. And when you look at Colin Kaepernick's protest, taking a knee silently to protest the killing of unarmed black men, and now, and through all of that, through every part of 10 years of nonviolent protest, of quiet, calm, the types of protests people say we're supposed to be doing, those people were called SOBs instead of drag them off the field for nonviolent, silent protests. So now that people are finally rioting and burning down buildings and causing havoc in the streets, I think we have to look at an actual legislative solution that will deal with these things on a federal level. The U.S. Congress has been considering anti-lynching legislation since the year 1900, and we still do not have a federal anti-lynching law. 120 years we've been working on this legislation. A new version of the bill passed in February of this year and is languishing the United States Senate. The fact that we cannot pass through something like anti-lynching legislation, something that I think all of us are clearly against, shows how broken and metastasized the political system is. So President Trump should push through that anti-lynching legislation, strengthen the hate crimes legislation in this country, which really has not been updated since 2009 when the Robert Byrd Act was instituted under the Obama administration, and have meaningful police reforms, not simply the cliches, more communications between police departments, more community policing. On my radio show, I have the Ku Klux Klan on about once a year, just to give me an update on what the Klan is up to. And about 3 years ago, they told me, and I'll go to some of the rallies, I hang out with some of the stores, because I like to know what's going on. Great barbecue. But one of the things that they told me is that the way they will want to hold on to power as they lost population is by entering law enforcement and the judicial system. We should have a major FBI investigation into the infiltration of white supremacy organizations and law enforcement nationwide. In addition to Justin Amash recently, just this week, introduced legislation that would hold police officers personally liable for the torts they commit while on duty. So right now, when a police officer kills somebody, beats somebody upside the head, cripples them, we, the taxpayers, pay off those civil suits. Cities such as Chicago have paid $500 million out in recent years just to pay for cops who have been beating the hell out of people. If you can go after that officer's pension, go after his car, go after his house, go after his children's college fund, that is how you stop officers from violating the law and acting so aggressively. If you notice in the video with George Floyd, what was the most, a couple things struck me. One was that it wasn't simply the officer with his knee on George Floyd's neck, but two other officers holding him down, another officer holding back the crowd, which lets you know that this is not something new. This is something that they do often. You saw them on the TMZ video beating Mr. Floyd in the back of the car, and the crowd stood there because this was nothing outside of the ordinary. We have to change that culture. We cannot simply respond to every video. We have to have legislation that changes that culture, that roots out white supremacy, that holds officers liable and actually makes changes. That is how you stop the protests and the riots. They're not just out there for cardio. They're out there because they want political change, and that's what has to happen. If you look at the early 1960s, what really calmed and quelled the social unrest then was the Civil Rights Act of 64, the Voting Rights Act of 65, public accommodation, fair housing, Title VII, Title IX, an entire suite, a decade's worth of legislation is what it took to calm those people down. And we need that same action now.
I think those are all great points. Obviously, former Vice President Joe Biden touched on a lot of that in his speech in Philadelphia on Tuesday. We heard the president this morning on a Fox News radio say that we do need some type of police reform, but he didn't necessarily enumerate what those reforms would be. What would be your advice to him in this position? Do you reach across the aisle to Democrats in Congress? Do you sign an executive order? I know this is unprecedented, but it seems like a no-brainer given the outcry of how horrible of a video this one particular instance was for members of both sides of the aisle.
Well, it's interesting because we say it's unprecedented, but we can actually look back to, I think the proper analog for Trump in many ways is Lyndon Johnson. So from 1938 until 1960, Lyndon Johnson was a Dixiecrat senator, our representative and then senator from Texas. He was known for blocking every single piece of civil rights legislation for over 20 years. Malcolm X famously had a speech where he said we need to kick LBJ back to his Texas cotton patch. What LBJ did, however, after the assassination of Kennedy and understanding that he would need the African-American vote going into the 64 election and also in 68, was reach across the aisle, bring in moderate voices in the civil rights movement, bring in Dr. King, Andrew Abernathy, the big six in civil rights, and then hammering out a Civil Rights Act in 64 that was a little bit softer than the civil rights acts that we had in 56 and in 60, but still strong enough to give some teeth to the movement. And this was spurred on because counterbalancing the weight of the voices of King and the Big Six, you had Stokely Carmichael, you had H.R.A.P. Brown, you had Malcolm, you had the Panthers, you had the Nation of Islam. So he understood that by bringing in the moderate voices and creating change through that, it would help to tamp down some of the more radical voices that really were talking about burning down and bringing down the system. So I think think that's an analog for what Trump can do, bring together a conversation of moderate voices who really want to make change on both sides of the aisle. You can't be doing the 1968 Nixon Law and Order speech, but rather bring in people who really want to reform and help benefit the community. You talk to people like the the Players Coalition with Malcolm Jenkins. Talk to groups like Black Lives Matter, who have been working in the space. Talk to traditional civil rights organizations like the NAACP, SCLC, Rainbow Push Coalition, and other groups such as that. And then hammer out what you can do executively instantly to stop the violence. And then also work through a legislative suite that can get support from both the Congressional Black Caucus and moderate Republicans. This is not as if we haven't done this before and haven't seen this before. As a question of, are we more fractured politically today than we were in the 1960s?
Well, I'd like to think that the answer to that question is no. And obviously, this is going to be a long battle. This isn't something that we solve immediately. But those are definitely some great steps to start down that track. I do want to take a second and talk about George Floyd's case in particular. We had news today that there will be new charges brought about against possibly the officer who had his knee on Mr. Floyd's neck or the other responding officers. In your experience as a defense attorney, what do you expect those charges to look like? Could this be an escalation from third-degree murder to something more severe, or are these going to be charges for the other officers? What's your opinion?
Well, one thing we're going to see today is the state level charges. So Keith Ellison, the attorney general, former Democratic representative to Congress, has said that he's going to bring state, probably civil rights charges against the officers for the violation of Mr. Floyd's civil rights. There are statutory differences between Minnesota and many other states, which kind of hamstring what the attorney general can do. As we saw in Georgia with the Ahmaud Arbery case, the attorney general and the Georgia Department of Justice were able to directly bring first degree murder charges against the McMichaels who killed Mr. Aubrey, set a special prosecutor, joined at home from Cobb County, and then I think they are actually going to court for their first appearance tomorrow in Georgia on the Ahmaud Arbery killing. I don't think Keith Ellison has the power to do that, but he does have the ability to bring state-level charges and conspiracy charges in particular between the officers, because it does appear that they acted in concert, that they had a common goal, and that the end result was the death of Mr. Floyd. I also believe that with the additional information that has come out since the third degree murder charges, there is enough information to go back to the grand jury and re-indict as first degree murder. People think the murder has to be quote unquote premeditated. You know, we're thinking about Silence of the Lamb. We're thinking about, Dexter, where you're just sitting down for court board laying out how you're going to murder somebody. No, according to Supreme Court jurisprudence, first degree murder can be sustained with malice aforethought, as in you consciously intend to cause the death of this individual, and that motive and that malice aforethought can be formed in an instant. So you don't have to have this grand, elaborate plan. You just simply have to have the instant idea and thought that you want to kill this person, and that counts as first-degree murder. So I argue that in this case, when the officer with his knee on Mr. Floyd's neck took Mr. Floyd's pulse, figured out that he was dead, and then kept his knee on his throat for another 3 minutes, you consciously had the object of killing this person. You wanted to make sure that even though he's already dead, you're giving him the equivalent of a kill shot to ensure that he was absolutely dead and had no chance of coming back. The other information we found that was incorrect in the initial charging documents, saying that Mr. Floyd refused to get into the back of the car. We have video from TMZ showing that he was in the back of the police car being beaten by those police officers. Also, the information that Mr. Floyd and the officer worked together doing security shows they had a pre-existing relationship, which would go towards proving malice. And then with regards to charges for the other officers, you have the fact that the other two officers were restraining this individual while he was being murdered. So you have accomplice liability. You would have things such as felony murder, where all parties involved in the felonious assault would be charged with murder along with the actual murderer. You have conspiracy charges if it can be shown through police radio information and other communications that they purposely planned to restrain and beat Mr. Floyd, even if they did not intend to murder him. So there are many additional charges which can be brought. And I think what is most telling is the fact that all officers have chosen to take their Fifth Amendment right to get self-incrimination. None have agreed to cooperate with prosecution. None have done what innocent people do, which is say, I'm an open book, I'll help however I can. Rather, they they are acting the way the gangs act, the way that the mafia acts, the way they accuse Tekashi 6ix9ine of acting by saying that we don't want any snitches, and all of them have pledged not to snitch on the others. I think that's a clear indication this was a criminal enterprise and not simply police work gone awry.
Well, Robert, these are difficult conversations to have, and I want to thank you for lending your expertise. I'm looking forward to picking this talk up sometime in the future, hopefully under better circumstances.
Absolutely, anytime.
To all of our viewers out there, hit subscribe if you haven't done it already. Hit the bell to get notified every time one of these interviews goes live. I'm Christian Daytalk. We'll see you next time.